Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Bob Hanna Stadium for Hens All Access's coverage of a game between the University of Delaware baseball Blue Hens and the LaSalle Explorers. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Derek Coleman. Derek, what are your thoughts on today's game?
Well, I think the Blue Hens need to come out here and get a victory, obviously. They've lost six out of their last eight, hit a little bit of a rough patch after having that 13-game win streak. So yep. A win here would be nice to set them up for conference play next week.
Yeah, we got their ace, their workhorse, Chad Cool, on the mound. Pro prospect coming into the season and hasn't really disappointed much. Again, he's hit a little bit of a rough patch as the team has, but when you look at his entire season, he's coming out strong.
Yeah, he's got 7 wins, 2 losses. He's second in the CAA in wins right now, so he's been pitching well for them this season, and they're going to count on his arm again to help them out.
And he'll be facing the LaSalle Explorer Ryan Donahue, who comes in with a 5.74 ERA and a 3-3 record. So he's not as prolific a pitcher as Chad Cool is, however, has had some success getting the 3 wins, and we'll see how he's able to fare.
It'll be interesting to see how LaSalle comes out of this game. Their overall record is 20-21, and they have a 13-5 Atlantic 10 record. So they've obviously been playing a lot better in the conference than out of the conference, and right now they're out of the conference. So we'll see what kind of game they come with.
Yes, we hope they stick with their trend a little bit and keep playing poorly out of conference and allow the Blue Hens to steal a win here. You can't talk about this Delaware team without talking about Jimmy Yezzo.
No, yeah. Jimmy Yezzo is leading the nation in hitting. He's up for the triple crown for the CAA right now, leading in batting average, home runs, and RBIs, leading in several other categories as well. And he's just a monster over there at first base.
Absolutely. He is really the premier hitter in this conference, if not one of the premier hitters in the country. When you think about it, he's up there with, you know, all the North Carolina standouts, University of Miami standouts. You have to put Jimmy Yezzo in that conversation, leading the country in average, leading the country in actually numerous other categories, in the top 10 in the country in 10 different categories. When you look at his first in average, first in hits, first in doubles, fourth in slugging percentage, sixth in RBIs, and tied for ninth in home runs. So he really is one of those players that you can build a program around. And being a junior, he is obviously one of the people that Coach Sherman is depending on.
Oh, most definitely. When I talked to Coach Sherman at the beginning of the season and asked him for a little preview outlook on what the season was going to be like this year, he mentioned Jimmy, first and foremost, as one of the top players that he was looking to excel this season.
As the Blue Hens jog out into the field and man their defensive positions, we get ready for what really will be a beautiful game on a beautiful day. You couldn't ask for much better weather here in Newark, Delaware.
Oh, yes.
And as we go into the national anthem, we will be back for the start of today's game. And we are back at the University of Delaware's Bob Hanna Stadium for the beginning of this game as Chad Cool will take on the leadoff hitter for the LaSalle Explorers, Dan Clem, the third baseman. Clem comes into today batting .342, second best average on the LaSalle Explorer team, so he's one of their better hitters to get things started off here against Chad Cool. We've brought up Yezzo D. What do you think about the other hitters on this team when you look at the Ferdinands, the DJ Longs. There's a lot of experience on this team, and there's some pretty prolific hitters.
Oh, yeah. Ferdinand is up right up there in home runs with Yezo. He's got 9 home runs. That puts him 3rd in the CAA. He also is 2nd in RBI. So with him and Yezo in the middle of that lineup, you know, solidifying the lineup. And then, you know, as a team, they just bat really well. They have a .320 batting average, which puts them in the top 4 in the nation, I think. So that is good. That is just really good for them.
Yeah, the offense has been getting it done pretty much all season. Again, we brought up the recent slide, and the offense kind of encapsulates that as well. But, and when you look at the season as a whole, they're hitting well, they're seeing pitches, and they're really showing that the experience that they've gained over the past couple years stands out. And when you look at, again, the DJ Longs, the Knickerbroegers, the Ferdinands, the Stoltzfuses, those are a lot of guys that have played a lot of baseball games for Coach Sherman, and experience is really where this team excels.
Yeah, and, you know, it's always nice to have guys that are from the area. You got DJ Long, who is a Delaware product, and it is nice to see him excel here at the University of Delaware.
Yeah, down there in Sussex Central in the southern part of Delaware. And now we will see the initial opening pitch of this game as Chad Cool begins his work against Dan Clem. Cool rocks and fires for the pitch. Catches the outside corner of the plate for strike number 1 as Cool gets things underway with a strike and immediately gets back, toes the mound. He is working extremely quick on his second pitch. Second pitch,
ooh,
misses low and outside for a ball, and that one was able to sneak by Warrington there. It's kind of a tale of two pitches in the first two pitches.
Yes, it was.
Calm strike and then a wild ball.
Hard shot right down the line.
Yeah, and Clem is able to line that one down the right field line for a fair ball, and he's digging for 2. Ferdinand over and under it, gets it in, and that will be a stand-up double to lead things off for Dan Clem.
Not the way you necessarily want to start off a game, but it's 0 outs, so we'll still be able to make it.
Yeah, that's what I was just about to say. Not exactly the ideal start for Chad Cool, but with a runner on, he really has to dig down now. No outs, settle down, and get the batter at the plate, who is Justin Kornblatt, the right fielder. Clem out of there on second has 5 stolen bases and 8 attempts this year, so he does have a little bit of speed and isn't afraid to take off. And the pitch, and that is lined to dead center. Jaquino closing is not able to make the play, and that will advance the runner. Runners on the corner on the single from Justin Kornblatt.
It looked like Jaquino stumbled there a little bit trying to catch that ball. I feel like if he hadn't stumbled, he might have been able to make a play on it.
Yeah, a little bit of a lost his footing there. Maybe wasn't as prepared to come forward. He was playing a little shallow, so I'm guessing that in most scenarios playing out there, he would have to turn and run back. But the bloop single finds its way down for Kornblatt. And now we'll see what Kevin Conroy can do against Chad Cool, and we'll see if Chad Cool, the ace of this lineup, can settle down and get some outs. The pitch is missed high for a ball. Count now 1 ball, no strikes, nobody out, 2 runners on here in the top of the first. It's a foul ball off the plate and back up into Conroy's leg, so that'll be strike number 1.
It's never fun when you foul it off yourself, Tim.
Definitely, probably pretty painful, but he looks like he's a tough guy, not wiping it off, not brushing it off at all, and getting right back in the batter's box. Conroy settles back in, as does Chad Cool. Checks the runner at first. And there is a high fly ball in the right field. Ferdinand is under it. We'll see if the runner tags. Ferdinand makes the play, fires in, and is able to hold the runner at third. A phenomenal play by Ferdinand.
And a phenomenal catch by Warrington. That throw was a little high, and if that had gotten by, the runner from third might have been able to score.
Yeah, you see, Warrington had to – a smaller stature guy, but he was able to use his athletic ability to jump up there and catch that high throw from Ferdinand.
Yeah, showing a little bit of ups on the play.
Ferdinand couldn't worry about being as accurate as he could be. It was all about speed, getting it in there, and trying to hold the runner at third. And he did, holding Dan Clem. So that's the first out of the day for the Delaware Blue Hens. Now they'll see cleanup hitter Mark Williams, the first baseman. Cool hits it on the outside corner of the plate for strike number 1. No balls, 1 strike, and 1 down here in the top of the first.
And Mark Williams is LaSalle's version of Jimmy Yezzo. He leads them in batting average right now, so let's see what he does here.
Cool misses outside. Count evens up at 1-1. Runners on the corners with one out here in the top of the first. See how Cool handles the situation. Here's the pitch. Ground ball to the right side of the infield. Looking to turn two. And they do. A phenomenal play by Yez over there at first. Getting the weak ground ball, charging it, making the throw to second, and then recovering to first for the catch and the second out, which is the third out of the inning. Cool is able to get out of the jam.
Couldn't have asked for a better way to end the inning after the way it started with those two quick hits.
Yeah.
It was good that they were able to get out and not give up any runs. So now the Blue Hens come up, and they got a chance to put the first runs on the board.
And now you really have to credit that to the experience of Chad Cool. Gives up the two no-out hits, runners on the corners with nobody out, and he's able to get a 1-2-3 after that. Actually, it's kind of like a 1-2 because he hit him into the double play. But that is a phenomenal poise, I guess he showed there.
And that is what you expect out of your ace. Sometimes you give up hits. Sometimes you let runners on base. But the key to that being an ace is that you don't let it rattle. You come out, you keep on pitching, and get out of the inning just like Cool did.
And now we're going to see what Donahue can do on the mound as he faces the first three hitters of the Delaware lineup. That's Joe Giacchino, DJ Long, and Jimmy Yezzo. And when you look at those three names, those are some run-scoring, table-setting machines there, as Giacchino is a phenomenal leadoff hitter, reaches base at an incredibly high rate. DJ Long in his 203rd consecutive start, which is a school record and pretty incredible. And then we've already brought up Jimmy Yezzo.
And the three of them, those are just, they're the standard of stability. There's only one missed start between the three of them in 44 games this season. So the top of the lineup is always the same, and it'll be the same again today.
Yeah, again, we brought up Yezzo so many times already, but for those of you at home, we will be talking about him all day. He leads the country in three major hitting categories, and he leads the CAA in the three major categories. He's in line for the Triple Crown right now in the conference.
Lining up just like Miguel Cabrera, trying to get a Triple Crown for the CAA, which is not bad at all to put on that resume as you're trying to get to the big leagues.
Yeah, I'm not sure we're going to see Yezzo at this time next year. He may be playing somewhere in, you know, Triple A.
Yeah, no, definitely.
If not the show, the way he's hitting. But now we're going to see what Joe Giacchino can do. The center fielder for the Blue Hens will step into the plate and face Donahue. The lefty speedster is really the ideal leadoff man. Gets on base, is able to manufacture a lot of base hits out of some ground balls and a lot of speed he has there.
Definitely, and as expected, he leads the team in steals, which is what you want from your leadoff batter. Get on base and then steal those bases.
He's also one of the more advantageous things he does for the team is he sees a lot of pitches. He's always the first hitter of the game. See a lot of pitches, allow everyone else to kind of get their timing down. So takes a strike there, but really no harm, no foul because he's just trying to see pitches. Donahue misses high for ball one. One ball and one strike. Here's the pitch. Misses outside for ball number two. Two balls and one strike. Misses outside for ball three. The count is now three balls and one strike. And being ahead in the count here, Giacchino can take his time, be a little bit more selective, and really work on getting on the base and setting the table for the rest of this Delaware lineup.
So let's see if he swings here, takes, waits for his pitch.
Is able to take ball four, and that'll be the first base runner for the Blue Hens as Giacchino reaches on a walk.
And that's a great way for the Delaware Blue Hens to start off, get a walk, get that runner on base, and you know with Giacchino out there, he's always a threat to steal second.
Donahue now has to start worrying about Giacchino out there on first base. And with a veteran player like DJ Long, you never know if a bunt's coming, trying to advance him, get him in scoring position for Yezzo. DJ Long takes ball number one, one ball and no strikes, one on with nobody down here in the bottom of the first inning.
I think they deliver now. The little guy in little suit.
Takes strike number one. The count evens up at one ball and one strike. Long settles in. The right-hander from Southern Delaware. Donahue attempts really a weak pickoff move there to get Jaquino. Jaquino slides back in easily.
But you can tell that Jaquino is already in Donahue's head. Like we said, Jaquino is a speedster. He can steal bases, and obviously Donahue knows that.
Yeah, I'm sure that's the number one thing written next to his name in the scouting report. Speed. DJ Long, not his pitch, takes strike number two, one ball and two strikes. Now he has to be a little bit more protective of the plate if he wants to advance Jaquino. And the pitch. Misses outside for ball number two. Able to work the count to even, two balls and two strikes.
Jaquino's getting way off of that bag over there, so let's see if he does try and take a base on them.
Donahue, the lefty, does have a good view of over there at first base of Jaquino being a little antsy. DJ Long rips one down the left field line. That'll be foul and out of play, but definitely good contact from the senior.
It's a good defensive swing right there. Get some contact on it. Get it out there, even if it is foul.
So both of the first two hitters have seen at least five pitches for the Blue Hens. Maybe they're working on wearing down Donahue early as DJ Long with a big cut goes down swinging on strikes.
Looks like he tried to take too big of a cut there, just straight up missed it.
So that's a strikeout number one for Donahue, and that will bring to the plate the premier hitter of the CAA, Jimmy Yezzo, first baseman for the Blue Hens. Jaquino still on first base. You don't know if he's ever going to make a move. The pitch misses low. I would guess that Donahue is going to be very careful with his pitches.
Yes. And definitely wouldn't want to put anything over the middle of the plate because if he does, it's going to go right over that 365 sign on the outfield fence.
And that is a shot down the right field line. Just foul. Yezzo is just off it for strike number one. One ball, one strike, one out here in the bottom of the first. Donahue taking his time on the mound. Fires. Big cut by Yezzo. Misses for strike number two. One ball and two strikes.
He got a piece of contact on the pitch before it, and he wanted more. Took that huge cut on that play.
Yeah, Donahue had him just fooled enough to miss, but if he connected with that one, it might still be in the air. And the pitch outside for ball number two. Two balls and two strikes. Donahue might have been trying to get him to chase that one a little bit with two strikes.
Yeah, swinging on the last two pitches before that. So, yeah, he was probably trying to get him to swing on a third in a row, get him out of here real quick.
Another pickoff attempt. Really not pickoff attempts trying to get Jaquino. Maybe just let him know that they know he's over there.
Yeah, so just keep him a little bit closer to that base because it's more comfortable for them. And
make him get his jersey dirty, stand up. I guess that's kind of their thought process. Ooh, not a good swing by Yezzo. When Jaquino goes, and he is safe. So Yezzo goes down swinging, but Jaquino is able to advance to second on a steal. So unusual from Yezzo and very, very common for Jaquino.
Like we said, Jaquino's the speedster, and it's true to form. He stole base in the first inning. So unfortunately, Yezzo struck out on that. So now there's two outs, but hopefully another stud in the lineup, Nick Ferdinand, can bring him home.
Yeah, Ferdinand coming up second on the team in home runs, another power hitter, and now he comes up with a runner in scoring position due to the steal from Jaquino. The right-hander settles in. Again, Donahue taking his time out there on the mound, really a methodical approach to this first inning. Misses well outside for ball number one.
A stark contrast to Cool in the first inning, who was wheeling and dealing, taking little to no time on the mound in between pitches.
Yeah, definitely obvious different approaches from the two pitchers. However, so far both have been effective, as through five outs we have no runs. I guess it's kind of early to be talking about that. Ferdinand with the good eye, two balls and no strikes. And Ferdinand is a dangerous hitter when he gets ahead in the count and is able to look for his pitch. As we mentioned, he has the power to put it over the fence at any point in time. Misses well outside yet again, three balls and no strikes, and now he has the opportunity to be extremely selective.
Donahue is really making his catcher work there behind the plate. He's all over the place trying to track down these balls, not to let Jaquino over to third.
Yeah, if it gets anywhere near a pass ball, Jaquino will be on his horse moving to third base. Misses inside for ball number four. A four-pitch walk for Ferdinand. So the two base runners from the Delaware team have both come on walks. So there's two walks and two strikes through four batters here. And now we'll see what third baseman E.J. Stoltzfus can do here against Donahue. Stoltzfus comes into the game batting 290. So he's a solid hitter, well above the Mendoza line, just under batting 300. Donahue is throwing a lot of off-speed here, and he's having a hard time controlling it as he misses for yet another ball, his fifth straight. Donahue gets the signal and finds the strike zone for strike number one.
Put that one right down the middle after throwing a little wide and outside. He figured, I better put this down the middle and get some strikes.
Yeah, and after five consecutive balls, you have to wonder if Stoltzfus was going to make him throw that strike and, you know, wasn't even really thinking about taking the bat off his shoulder. And Stoltzfus lines one just up the middle. That'll fall for a base hit. Chiquino's coming around, and he will score. Runners at first and second following the RBI single from Stoltzfus.
Yeah, center fielder George Smith Jr. didn't even try to make that throw. Chiquino got a nice jump on the ball, and that run was all but a forgotten conclusion.
Yeah, just a nice piece of hitting by Stoltzfus. Works the count a little bit and then just puts it right where it needs to, drops in front of the center fielder and between the shortstop and second baseman for an RBI single. And now we'll see left fielder Cameron Travellini, another guy with great speed for the Delaware Blue Hens. Ferdinand out there on second base doing his best Chiquino impression, trying to draw some attention. However, he does not have that notorious speed.
No, he doesn't have the same wheels that Chiquino has out there.
Donahue continues his control problems as he finds himself two balls and no strikes here against Travellini. Last thing he wants is another base runner. Misses again, three balls and no strikes, and now Travellini finds himself in a similar situation to Ferdinand, where he gets to look for exactly his pitch and really wait it out and make Donahue throw strikes.
So we'll most likely see Travellini take this pitch.
And Donahue agreed with you and threw it pretty much right down the middle.
As expected.
Expecting a take for Travellini there. And Travellini rips one right off of Donahue's arm. Donahue was able to track it down and make the play at first. However, he took a pretty hard shot right off his throwing arm, so you never know how that's going to affect him as the game moves
forward.
That
was an impressive play by Donahue to get that ball down and get it over to first place. It looked like a tight call over there, but hopefully that ball hitting him did not give him much of a problem for the rest of the game. We'll have to see.
And when we return, we will continue today's coverage for Hens All Access of Delaware versus LaSalle Baseball.
Did you replay that and see if he's really out?
I can't, unfortunately. I was thinking about it.
I'd say he was out.
It was close. It's tough because when you're watching it through there, you don't really get the clear picture, so I don't really see it.
Welcome back to the University of Delaware's Bob Hanna Stadium. Following a first inning of baseball where the Blue Hens were able to take a 1-0 lead over the LaSalle Explorers. Now in the second inning, we will see Joey Ravert, Ryan Welling, and George Smith Jr. for the Explorers facing the ace that we have talked about numerous times, Chad Cool.
Joey Rabbert, one of those rarities, bats left and throws right.
Chad Cool is able to find a strike, number one, for on Rabbert. Cool working quickly yet again, and the pitch. Ooh. And he puts it off the right knee of Rabbert, and he will jog down to first base, hit by pitcher.
Rabbert took that real well. He didn't even blink. He hit and took him in the knee, threw his bat to the side, and took his walk down to first base.
A little bit of that tough guy persona of baseball players, not wanting to show any weakness, show any pain, but, you know, it probably did. He took a fastball right off a kneecap.
Yeah.
And yet again, second inning straight, the leadoff batter is on, and Cool will have to work his way through the inning with runners on base. It is also worth mentioning that Niggerbrugge and Long out there in the middle infield have turned more double plays than any other pairing in school history, so they know what to do if there's a ground ball at the middle.
Oh, most definitely, and they showed that in the first inning.
As there's a ground ball over to third base. And that'll be another double play as Stoltzfus tosses it over to DJ Long at second, who tosses it to Yezo at first to complete the double play.
And as if on cue, you knew.
Yeah.
Somehow, double plays, Delaware, we turn them, and that worked out really well.
Yeah, you can't ask for a much better defense behind you for Chad Cole so far, getting two double plays to get himself out of some weak jams. And there's the pitch on George Smith Jr., the center fielder, and that'll be a strike one. Smith Jr. took a cut at that one, fouls it back for strike number two. No balls and two strikes as Cool gets ahead in the count. Cool, little careful with that pitch. Misses outside, ball one. One ball and two strikes with two down here in the top of the second. Misses outside yet again, even count up.
He is really trying to get Smith to go out over the plate and probably get a little bit of a piece on something, but not too much that he sends it too far.
Misses outside on three consecutive pitches to load the count. Three balls and two strikes with two down. George Smith Jr. hasn't taken his bat off his shoulder yet. And Cool misses outside for the walk after being ahead in the count, no balls and two strikes, a four-pitch walk.
A very interesting at-bat. Smith, as you said, never had to take his bat off his shoulder. It was just unfortunate because Chad Cool did get ahead in the count to begin with.
And now the shortstop, Colin McGowan, will come to the plate and see if he can advance. And there's the pitch Cool is looking for in the last at-bat. He finds the outside corner of the plate for strike number one. As that one is hit into shallow right field, and that'll be foul ball. Yezo gave pursuit but was not able to get there.
Yezo just doesn't quite have the wheels to get over there and make that play over on the warning track.
Maybe if we had one of those three speedy outfielders over there at first base, but they probably wouldn't take advantage of the hitting ability that Yezo has either.
No.
So you take what you can get in your first baseman with Jimmy Yezo, and Cool will go back to work against McGowan. Missing high for ball one. One ball and two strikes. Two down here in the top of the second. Cool being a little bit more methodical in his approach to this inning. Misses outside yet again. Two balls and two strikes.
He is really trying to work that outside corner. We've seen that in the last two at-bats right now. So
yeah, both at-bats he got ahead. No balls and two strikes. Then missed outside on all the subsequent pitches. That one McGowan gets a piece of and fouls back. Count will remain even at two balls and two strikes.
Again, another pitch on the outside edge of the plate.
That time he got McGowan to chase it. However, he was able to fight it off and foul it back. Cool Cool checks the runner at first. And here's the pitch. And that'll be weakly grounded down the left line. Cool chases it, fields it cleanly and makes the throw. However, it's not in time to get the speed of him going.
Tough play for Cool to make. It was right down the third baseline. He had to run all the way over and then turn and wheel it over to first, and it just wasn't going to happen on this one.
Yeah, it almost was like a full swing bunt for McGowan there as he tried to give it a ride and ended up hitting it about 30 feet down the third baseline.
Cool gave a good chase to it too, but just not fast enough to get there in time to make the throw as well.
So with runners on first and second, we will see the second baseman, Brandon Day, the nine-hole hitter for the Explorers, step to the plate to face Chad Cool. And he rips one down the first baseline. Yezo bobbles it, picks it up, and is still able to make the play for the third out. So two consecutive innings, two batters stranded for the LaSalle Explorers, and Cool finds his way out of some jams to keep this game scoreless for the Explorers.
Yezo tried to make that one real interesting. What looked to be a somewhat routine ground ball, knocked it down, had to pick it back up and run over to first base to get the out.
Yeah, he never looked worried, although maybe he should have been because McGowan was booking it down the base path. But Yezo was able to make the play and get Cool out of a jam for the second consecutive inning. I'd like to remind you, for everything Blue Hens Athletics, keep tuned to Hens All Access. For the Blue Hens in the bottom of the second inning, we will see Zach Lopes, the designated hitter, Brock Niggerbrugger, the shortstop, and the nine-hole hitter, Ty Warrington, the catcher, before we make our way back to the top of the lineup.
The funny thing is that people would think that the bottom of the order is where you put your not as capable batters, but we still have two batters coming up that bat over 300 for the season. So,
yeah, when you look at Zach Lopes and Brock Niggerbrugger, the shortstop, they're two pretty solid hitters. They hit well for average, have good speed. And Niggerbrugger, as you mentioned before, has started all 44 games. So, he's definitely not anything to laugh at the bottom half of his lineup.
So LaSalle is not quite out of the woods yet.
And Ryan Donahue knows that, so I'm sure he's not going to be throwing his B-rate stuff at all. He's going to be throwing his A stuff trying to get these guys out. Lopes comes into today's game batting .311 as he steps to the plate. Starting 28 games for the Blue Hens, so he's another experienced player. And he takes the first pitch for a strike. No balls and one strike. Donahue continues his slow-moving strategy as he misses outside for one ball and one strike.
And Lopes is one of those Delaware products we were talking about. Went to a local Salesianum High School here, a transfer from Coastal Carolina, who's finding success at the University of Delaware.
And there he rips one into right center. Smith Jr. giving chase, and Kornblatt, the right fielder, is able to find his way underneath it for out number one. And now we will see that shortstop that we brought up a few times defensively. Brock Niggerbrugger step into the batter's box to face Donahue. Another guy with good speed on this Delaware team. If he gets on base, you can expect some fireworks. Takes a big cut at that one. No balls and one strike. Takes a swing at that one at the shortstop, McGowan. Bobbles it again. Makes the throw. Safe. As that speed we brought up for Niggerbrugger pays off, and he's able to beat out a bobbled ground ball.
A double bobble at that. He bobbled it once, tried to pick it up again, bobbled it again, and still almost made the out at first.
Now we'll see the catcher, Ty Warrington, the nine-hole hitter for this Blue Hen team, step to the plate. With one out, the sack bunt to advance the runner is alive, but we'll see if they let him just swing away. Strike right down the middle for Donahue. Warrington, a phenomenal defensive catcher, manages these pitchers for the Blue Hens so well. Donahue misses outside, one ball and one strike with one down here in the bottom of the second inning. Negabroga takes his lead off of first base. And fouls it straight back. Negabroga was running on the pitch, but he'll have to return to first on the foul ball.
Don't know if Coach called a hit and run there or if he called the steal and Warrington just decided to swing for it.
Yeah, definitely had the looks of a hit-and-run situation, but it's all for naught as the foul ball brings him back to first. Donahue settles in, and here's the pitch. Another cut by Warrington, fouled back.
Warrington looks to be a little bit behind these pitches, slicing them right now, so let's see if he tries to get in a little bit more in front of them.
The good news is with every foul ball, he gets a little bit closer, so we'll see if he is able to figure it out by the end of this at-bat. Donahue misses outside to even the count of two balls and two strikes.
Looks like he tried to get him to chase something that was out over the plate, threw something way outside on him.
Yep, a little Chad Cool-esque, as he was doing that in the top half of this inning. That one's right down the middle, and it's fouled straight back at the announcer's booth. And that'll be a 2-2 count. It remains.
We almost had to duck over here, Tim.
Yeah, if I had a glove, I would have made a play. And now we will get back to the action with a 2-2 count with one down here in the bottom of the second inning. Donahue gets the call on the inside part of the plate. Warrington doesn't agree, but he will walk back to the dugout, struck out.
Interesting approach from Donahue, was working the outside of the plate for most of that at bat and then came in and finished him off on the inside.
Yeah, he got his third strikeout on really an unusual pitch so far. Both pitchers are working the outside part of the plate mainly, and that time he pounds it inside and gets the call for strike three. And now we'll see Giacchino get in. He scored the only run of today's game after reaching on a walk in the first inning. And Giacchino gets up under that one, and that'll be down for a single into left center field. Smith Jr. was not able to get under it. And now that'll bring to plate DJ Long with runners on first and second.
Giacchino's gotten off to a great start this game, a hit and a walk and two at-bats with also a run to go along with it.
Yeah, we mentioned it. He's kind of the table setter for this Blue Hen lineup. He's the mover and the shaker at the top of the lineup that gets on base and really makes things happen. And now you have tremendous speed on the base paths with Negerbrugger on second and Giacchino on first. So any hit here by DJ Long could be one or two runs. Long takes strike number one. No balls and one strike. That one grounded at the third baseman. Clem is able to make the play over at first and gets DJ Long for the third out of the inning. So two runners stranded for the Blue Hens as we make our way into the third inning.
Clem debated just turning around and tagging Negerbrugger for a second, but decided to go and make the throw over to first base for the easier out.
Yeah, I'm not sure he wanted to go chasing around a shortstop in the middle of the infield, so he just made the safe play at first. When we return, we will get the third inning here at Bob Hanna Stadium between the LaSalle Explorers and the Delaware Blue Hens. Thank you. And we're back here at the Bob Hanna Stadium here at the University of Delaware as Chad Cool gets ready to face the top of the LaSalle Explorer lineup with Dan Clem, the third baseman, Justin Kornblatt, the right fielder, and Kevin Conroy, the left fielder, coming to plate here in the third.
Even though he's allowed some base runners today, Chad has not allowed any runs today. He's had some good defense behind him. Let's see if the Blue Hens keep it up in the third inning.
Yeah, the batter Dan Clem had one of the hardest hit balls of the day so far in a double in the first inning, so we'll see if he's able to match that performance here as he takes ball number one inside. That one he takes a swing on, pops it up into left center field. Center fielder Giacchino gets under it and makes the play. Routine fly ball for Giacchino out there in center field.
They had a little conference there between Niggerbrugger, Giacchino, and Trevellini to decide who was going to catch that ball, and Giacchino seems to have won.
Yeah, communication amongst the outfielders and infielders is really vital. You don't want to see people run into each other. They handled that well on the routine fly ball, and Giacchino makes the out.
Cool.
Excuse me?
And true to form, Chad Cool is moving fast through these batters.
Yeah, it's definitely been his MO so far today is get back on the mound and get ready to throw. Almost as soon as these LaSalle batters are in the box, he's in his windup. As Kornblatt lines that one down the left field line, foul ball, that'll be strike two, no balls and two strikes. So the quick approach so far at this batter has worked for Cool. It'll be nice to have a quick inning for him after allowing some base runners in both of the first two. Ground ball to Yezu. Yezu makes a diving play to his knees, flips it to Cool. A phenomenal defensive play along the right side of the infield by Jimmy Yezu.
It was a beautiful dive by Yezu to stop that ball from getting out of the infield, and then a great cover by Cool to get over there to first base.
Yeah, Yezu even had the time to bobble a little bit from his knees there and still had enough time to get the ball to Cool for the out. A great play by this Delaware defense.
Because we know that Dan Clem can run for LaSalle Explorers, so that was a great play by the both of them.
And true to form, he's quickly working on Kevin Conroy. Conroy lines it into left field. Travellini misplays and it gets over his head, and that'll be a double for Kevin Conroy.
I'm wondering if the wind took that a little bit. Travellini thought that it was coming on more of a straight line, but it seemed to lift a little bit over his head.
Yeah, he looked like he was under it and was waiting for it almost, and the ball kind of took off and clears his head. So Conroy finds himself standing on second with two outs here in the top of the third. And now, Mark Williams, the first baseman and premier hitter of this LaSalle lineup, steps to the plate, seeing if he can pull in this runner in scoring position with two outs. Cool's found himself in trouble before, though, and he's worked his way out of it. So,
and he has two outs, so there shouldn't be much to worry about for him here.
There's a hard hit ball fouled on the third baseline. Strike one.
Cool is going with the fast break approach. Like an NBA team here with these batters. He's not giving them any time to breathe. He's all up on them.
Yeah, as soon as they step into the batter's box, they have to be prepared to field the pitch because Cool's not waiting for them to take their time and tap their cleats. There's a ground ball up the middle. Niggerbrugge fields it. Over to Yezu for out number three. Another runner stranded. No harm done. As the Blue Hens are able to make it out of the third inning scoreless.
It was a high bouncer. It looked like it might have got through the middle for a little bit, but Niggerbrugger was able to go over there and make the play.
Yeah, Mark Williams, as I mentioned, the premier hitter on this LaSalle lineup so far, has grounded into a double play and grounded out up the middle. So Cool's handling their better hitters pretty well, and he's allowing some of their less prolific hitters to reach base.
Because if you look at the box score for this right now, LaSalle's got four hits as opposed to Delaware's two, but we did get that run in the first inning.
Yeah, it's all about timing. It's all about the timing of the hits. Delaware was able to put a hit together with a runner in scoring position, especially when that runner is Giacchino, as it was. He's going to score on a ground ball from second base.
Yeah.
So, it's all about being opportunistic at the plate. When you have runners on, you have to be able to string hits together. And while LaSalle has gotten base runners, they haven't been able to find that one critical hit that'll put a runner across the plate. And to lead off this inning for the Blue Hens, we will have Jimmy Yezu. Struck out in the first, but that is not the norm for this pro prospect, really, Jimmy Yezu, followed by Nick Ferdinand and E.J. Stoltzfus. Stoltzfus had the RBI in the first inning, so he's part of the first blood drawn for the Blue Hens. And as the third batter in this inning, he hopefully will have the opportunity to do that yet again. The lefty Yezo settles in. Donahue takes his time preparing to attack this prolific CAA leader in batting average. Yezo thought about it, is able to check his swing, ball number one. Yezo gets underneath that one, and that is a long way, but that will be a foul ball. If it was straight, it was gone.
He put that straight over the bullpen for the LaSalle Explorers. Just a little piece of what Jimmy Yezo can do if he gets a bat on the ball.
Yeah, just a little peek at the power that he has. If Donahue doesn't keep him fooled, that one might be, as you mentioned, over that 365 sign in right center field. And he wanted at that time taking a big cut, fouling it straight back. One ball and two strikes with nobody out here in the bottom of the third. Ooh, Donahue did maybe a little brushback pitch there, yeah. Way inside. Yezo was able to get out of the way.
Donahue didn't like the way Yezo was swinging at those last two pitches, so he told him to back up a little bit with that inside pitch.
Yeah, a little brushback there from Donahue, but Yezo's seen it all before, and he settles back in. And that one he gets up under to right field, and Kornblatt is able to find his way underneath it. He kind of jammed himself a little bit there and didn't get all of it, and that'll be out number one.
Yeah. Those right field catches aren't as routine as you think either. On this field, the sun sets right over. You're looking up into the air. The sun is right there.
Yeah, Sherman talked about that earlier this week in Hens All Access's Blue Hens lunch break. He talked about playing right field, which is what he did in his playing career, and how difficult it is managing that sun. And that one, Ferdinand gets under to deep left center. Center fielder Smith Jr. on his horse, and he will not get to it. And this will be at least a double, maybe more for Ferdinand. He's on his way to third, cutoff throw. And he is in for a triple for Nick Ferdinand. A phenomenal piece of hitting from the senior.
Ferdinand wasted no time getting in there. Swung on the first pitch, sent it all the way to the fence, and got all the way around the bases. Impressive hitting and base running by Ferdinand.
And you could tell as soon as that left his bat, he was thinking three. He wasn't thinking double. He was thinking get around for a triple. Was on his horse the entire way, and the hustle pays off as he finds himself standing on third.
And this is Ferdinand's fourth triple of the year, which leads the Blue Hens.
And now Stoltzfus has the opportunity to bring in another RBI with a runner in scoring position. Donahue misses way outside for ball number one.
And with four triples on the year, Ferdinand moves himself into the top three in the CAA in triples.
Ferdinand definitely one of the better hitters and obviously one of the better base runners getting all those triples. Has the speed to do it. Donahue misses outside yet again for ball number two. And now he takes his time, takes a walk around the mound, trying to settle himself after giving up the triple and two consecutive very outside balls. Misses outside yet again, ball number three. Stoltzfus finds himself ahead in the count, three balls and no strikes with one out and a runner on third.
I wonder if Donahue is rattled a little bit. That was a big hit that Ferdinand got off him. He might not have his bearings under him yet.
Yeah, with the long foul ball from Yezo and then the long hit from Ferdinand, he is a little rattled here, and he actually walks Stoltzfus to put runners on the corners for Cameron Travellini. Travellini grounded out to the pitcher. He's the one that had the hard hit shot off of the pitcher's arm earlier in the game.
And you're wondering if that is affecting Donahue now, because since that pitch, he hasn't seemed to be dealing as well as he was earlier.
Travellini attempted a bunt, tried to pull it out.
Looked like he barely got that bunt out of there before the ball got there. Almost might have tipped it.
Yeah, I think he did tip it, and they're going to call that a strike. Now they're going to let him swing away, and Donahue gets the call on a low strike, no balls and two strikes, as Travellini finds himself behind in the count.
Donahue is definitely looking to get this strikeout, or worst-case scenario, get Travellini to ground out into a double play.
That'll probably be the best-case scenario.
Yeah, very true.
For Donahue, is he'd be able to get out of this inning with no harm done. But now he misses outside. One ball, two strikes with one out.
And there he goes back to working that outside plate when he gets ahead in the count.
Yeah, both pitchers are kind of pounding the outside part of the plate, trying to get batters to reach a little bit when they get ahead, but neither of them are really slamming the door and getting many strikeouts. Travellini gets up under that one to center field. Smith Jr. underneath. Ferdinand waiting to tag. He will, and he's in. The throw from Smith Jr. will be cut off by the pitcher. No throw. That'll be an RBI sac fly for Travellini.
Yeah, Smith Jr. definitely did not get enough on that throw to get it all the way to home. The pitcher tried to cut it off, and when he turned, or actually first baseman tried to cut it off, and when he turned to look to throw it to home, it was too late.
And now Zach Lopes, the designated hitter for the Blue Hens, will step to the plate with a runner on first in E.J. Stoltzfus. Blue Hens now lead 2-0, two outs in the bottom of the third. Here's the pitch. In there for a strike. No balls and one strike. Lopes flew out to right field in his first at-bat, attempting to better that performance here in the third inning. Big swing there by Lopes to no fruition. Two strikes and no balls. Ooh, a little chin music there from Donahue, brushing Lopes off the ball up around his chin.
Gave him the high heat there, Tim.
Yeah, and that'll be ball number one, so it's one ball and two strikes. And you have to wonder if Zach Lopes is thinking about that last pitch. That one's on the outside part. Flied into right field. Just foul.
And true to form, Donahue, again, works the outside of the plate and when he's ahead in the count.
Yeah, and Lopes was able to get just enough wood to stay out of a strikeout, I guess you could say, by fouling it down the right field line.
We'll see if the Blue Hens pick up on that eventually, because if I can pick up on it up in the booth, they must be seeing it down there.
Yeah, I'm sure they're working on adjustments to make, but when he's missing outside, you just have to continue to take them. And now he goes the opposite way with it and lines a foul ball down the left field line to stay alive. Lopes behind in the count, one ball and two strikes with two down here in the top of the fourth. Bottom of the third, excuse me. Ground ball foul on the third baseline.
Traveling.
Lopes.
Lopes. Lopes is fighting to stay alive in this at-bat, working really hard to foul these pitches off and playing good defensive baseball.
And more importantly, he's making Donahue work. More pitches he sees, the more likely they're going to get into that bullpen. Once you get in the bullpen, anything can happen. Big swing by Lopes, and that'll be strike number three. Donahue's fourth strikeout of the day will bring us into the fourth inning when we return. Stick with us here at Hens All Access. And welcome back to Bob Hanna Stadium as we get the fourth inning underway. Chad Kuhl will face
Designated hitter Joey Ravert, catcher Ryan Welling, and center fielder George Smith Jr. of LaSalle. None of them really were able to create much damage in their first at-bats, being hit by a pitch, grounded into a double play, and then walking. But Cool allowed two of them to get on base more under his own power than anything they did. Swings at that one, fouls it high and out of play for strike number one. This is outside for 1-1.
I'm naming schools that I think last week.
Here's the pitch. One on for strike two. One ball and two strikes with nobody down here in the top of the fourth.
Cool got ahead in the count. Let's see if he tries to work the outside part of the plate.
See if he pounds the outside. Become like a record player up here in the booth. That time he goes inside and it's grounded foul down the first baseline.
It was all Ravert could do just to get a piece on that to stay alive.
Mm-hmm. Seen some good battles from some pitchers and hitters out here so far today. A lot of foul balls, a lot of long at-bats. That one is in play. Yezo will not be able to make a play, and that will be a single for Ravert.
Yezo was trying to take the time machine back to a couple of innings ago when he made that diving save to make the throw out at first, but it wasn't happening this time.
Yeah, gave it a little bit of a chase before realizing he was not going to be able to get there, and that'll be yet again a runner on base with nobody out for Cool. Third consecutive inning.
And yet no runs have come across the plate. He's been able to work these situations perfectly and get out of them.
And it goes worth mentioning, this infield is tremendous at turning double plays, so anything on the ground, you can almost expect it. Cool gets Welling swinging for strike number one and immediately sets up for pitch number two in the at-bat, working his rapid pace. There's the pitch. Misses just inside for ball number one. One ball and one strike. And this one's popped up into shallow right field. DJ Long is under, and he will make the routine fly ball catch.
Another easy routine out for the University of Delaware Blue Hens as they try to help Chad Cool keep that runner on first base.
And it seems that Cool maybe enjoys the pressure of that. I don't really understand. He doesn't really start pitching and getting quality outs until he gets a runner on base. Misses inside there for ball number one. One ball and no strikes. This is the center fielder George Smith Jr. at the plate. Reached earlier on a walk. Cool doing his best not to allow that to happen again. Throwing a strike to even the count up. One ball and one strike.
Let's see.
Kicking off. Runners remained at first and second.
Yeah, I was surprised that Jaquino looked to run on that. The ball was hit to left field, even though the center fielder caught it, but he thought second of it halfway through and turned back.
Yeah, probably a smart play. And, you know, taking off a little bit, making them make the throw to third base isn't bad because you never know if he's going to airmail one. He might be able to get a cheap base or two.
Very true. With no outs in the inning before that, they would not want to get two outs that way.
Yeah, so Ferdinand will step to the plate with runners on first and second. Ferdinand already with a triple today and a walk before being stranded on third base.
Even at second base, Jaquino is in the pitcher's head. Scroy just stepped off the mound.
Checking on him again before the pitch. And that'll be in there for a strike. No balls and one strike. Yeah, Jaquino seems to be in the head of every pitcher when he's on the base pass. That speed is something to keep pitchers awake at night. Pitchers have nightmares of Joey Jaquino out there. There's a swing by Fernand, popped up into right field. That'll be a foul territory fly ball out for Williams.
And that sun setting over into the right field area. Even Williams there at first base almost fell victim to it, had to put his hand up there real high to block it out so he could make the catch.
And now for the third time today,
E.J. Stoltzfus will come to the plate with a runner in scoring position. He's already plated two runs. Now we'll see if he can plate one more, or two more, or three more. I guess the possibilities are endless for a hitter like this. And there's a hot shot right back at the pitcher. Scroy's able to handle it and will get the out at first base. So two runners stranded for the Delaware Blue Hens. No more damage done here in the bottom of the sixth.
Scroy is able to get out of that inning with no runs done. Hopefully the LaSalle Explorers can put some runs on them for him so he can possibly steal this victory from Donahue.
Yeah, I guess hopefully for Scroy, hopefully for the Blue Hens, that doesn't happen. And Chad Cool is able to continue his shutout. When we return, we'll see if he can here in the top of the seventh. Welcome back to Hens All Access's coverage of a baseball game between University of Delaware and the LaSalle Explorers. For those of you that have been trying to get this coverage for the first part of this game, we've had a few technical difficulties, but we're back here now, and we will take you through the duration of this game. The Blue Hens are already ahead 4-0 as we enter the seventh inning. Also, if you would like to see the coverage of our first six innings here, it will be up on Hens All Access in our archive footage. So look for that if you want to see what was going on the earlier part of this afternoon. Here's Cool with the pitch to start the seventh inning. A big cut by Colin McGowan, the shortstop for LaSalle Explorers. Again, welcome to Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Derek Coleman, and we will be taking you through the duration of today's game. Strike number two called on Colin McGowan, the shortstop.
Two quick strikes for Cool. He looks like he might be trying to go the distance, trying to get these batters out real quick.
Yeah, he's been operating quick all day. A good play behind the plate by Warrington to keep the ball ahead of him. One ball and two strikes. Chad Cool operating at his traditional rapid pace as he had most of today. Misses low, two balls and two strikes to even the count with nobody out here in the top of the seventh.
McGowan wanted to swing at that, but he held back.
Yeah, Cool almost got him swinging for the third strike. That time he doesn't need him to swing because he's going to get the strike three called. One out here in the top of the seventh. Cool has really come alive since the beginning of the fifth inning, pitching extremely well, allowing only one runner to reach base, and that was on a strikeout. So he's pitched well the past two and a third innings. Again, the one batter, the strikeout that I'm referring to was a strikeout that got by Warrington and the runner was able to run down to first base. So really no fault of Cool that the runner reached base. As he misses outside there, one ball and one strike on Brandon Day, the second baseman for the Explorers. Brandon Day has not had much success today with a ground out to the pitcher and a fly out to right field. And that one is popped sky high to the right part of the infield. DJ Long calls everyone else off and makes the play for out number two of the seventh inning.
DJ Long with those shades on over there doesn't need his hands to block out the sun that's coming in over right field.
Looking like he knows what he's doing, like he's a hometown player who knows the lay of the land. Maybe a little home field advantage there. You know if you're playing on the right side of this baseball field, you better have some shades and your hat down low. And now we're back to the top of the lineup in Dan Clem for the Explorers. As Cool misses high for pitch ball number one to Clem. Clem started today's game off with a little bit of a firework, a double, however, hasn't done much since, flying out to center field and striking out.
And like most other LaSalle Explorer runners today, Clem got stranded in the first inning.
Yes, he did. As you said, almost everybody. You've either been doubled off on a double play or stranded. Strike two called. Two balls and two strikes. Correction. Strike one called. Two balls and one strike. Ball three outside. Count will be 3-1 with two outs. There's a hot shot and a great line out catch by DJ Long. DJ Long has played phenomenal defense so far in this game.
DJ Long has made a couple of Derek Jeter-esque plays, made that nice line drive catch right there, and he is really helping to keep that zero on the board.
He's had two hard hit ground balls to his left where he's able to maneuver over there. He had the one, as we're calling it, the Derek Jeter-esque play out there to his right, and then that line out is to his right, tail right back into him. Gets the out, and when we return, we'll get to see the bottom of the seventh inning where Cameron Travellini, Zach Lopes, and Brock Niggerberger will come to the plate for the Blue Hens.
Give a round of applause for Kendall and Trey. All right, I'm Mark. Get set. Go.
And as we move into the bottom of the seventh inning, we will see the third pitcher for the LaSalle Explorers in freshman Austin Clark.
So obviously Dominic Segroy was just a placeholder for Austin Clark. Austin Clark has a 3.06 ERA, so our ERA on the LaSalle Explorers is improving. He's 2-1 in 18 and 16 appearances this season, Tim.
Yeah, freshman, obviously one of their more impressive freshmen, as he has many appearances and a fairly low ERA, just over 3. He will be facing Cameron Travellini, who has an RBI today and a sac fly, a ground out, and a strikeout. Travellini faces it, and he grounds it up the middle. Shortstop able to get over there and throws it away. That will be a base hit for Travellini as the throw from McGowan got away. Not sure if that throw was on target, if he was going to be able to.
Even if the throw was on target, Tim, I feel like Travellini did beat that throw out, but heady play by the catcher to get over there and cover, because if he was not over there, Travellini would have easily taken second as well.
Yeah, Travellini has the speed to make those mistakes turn into bigger mistakes, take advantage of those type of things. But the heads-up play by Welling got down there and held Travellini at first. Now we'll see if Zach Lopes can advance the runner with no outs. Shows bunt, and Clark misses outside. So in Clark's first batter faced, he gives up a base hit. Shows bunt again. attempts the bunt this time, but fouls it back for strike number one. One ball and one strike. We'll see if they keep the bunt on or allow him to swing away here in the third pitch at the at-bat. Pickoff attempt on Travellini. Travellini not nearly as far in his lead as we've seen Giacchino, but Clark still wanting to keep him as close as possible.
Freshman just trying to keep tags on all bases.
Checks runner at first in the pitch. Travellini shows bunt yet again before pulling it back and accepting a ball. Two balls and one strike.
Those two good takes on those balls on squared bunts for Travellini. I mean, for
Zach Lopes.
Zach Lopes. My apologies.
Travellini's out there at first. Lopes shows bunt again before taking ball number three. Three balls and one strike. It appears as if they're going to allow this bunt to go on as long as possible.
Until he gets two strikes up on the board, they want Lopes to get this bunt.
Or advances the runner.
But he might take on this one, try and get that walk. Nope, a bunt in there.
Lays it down, successfully will advance the runner. And the sacrifice bunt advances Travellini to second base. And that will bring up Brock Niggerbrugge.
Now batting for Delaware, number five, Brock Niggerbrugge.
So you can't ask for a much more well-executed sacrifice bunt. Only took him five attempts, accepted a couple balls, and then laid it down the right first baseline.
With a four-run lead and no outs, Delaware can definitely afford to play small ball. And with Chad Cool pitching the way he's pitching, they are not afraid right now of what LaSalle is doing on offense.
Yeah, they're just trying to get one more run, one more insurance run. Get that Aflac. As Clark misses outside for ball number one. One ball and no strikes. And the pitch. Hard hit ball right at the third baseman, Clem. Clem checks the runner at second before throwing to first to get the out. Two down here in the bottom of the seventh.
And it looks like the freshman, Clark, might be able to get out of this inning unscathed after starting off with an opening hit, giving up an opening hit. And he's gotten down to two outs right now, and hopefully for him, he can get this third out and get out himself out of the inning.
As long as Ty Warrington isn't able to do some damage here, he came in today, the catcher, batting 268. So he's no slouch on the side of the plate either. Fouls that one straight back for strike number one. Good swing there by Warrington. Clark settles in. And the pitch. Large lead for Travellini out there at second. No one covering the base, so why not?
Looked like that pitch got away from Clark a little bit. Luckily, Welling was able to reel it in behind the plate.
Yeah, all three LaSalle pitchers so far have kept Welling well on his toes behind the plate. The pitch well outside. Wellington corrals it. Two balls and one strike with two down here in the bottom of the seventh. And the pitch. Big swing from Ty Warrington for strike number two. Count evens up, two balls and two strikes with two down. Here we go. Checks the runner at second base and the delivery. Runner goes, popped into right field. Corin Blatt and Williams giving chase. Williams mishandles it and falls down to make the catch. That son that we brought up so many times was playing games with him.
That is an impressive catch by Williams. Clark should definitely give him congratulations on that. The Blue Hens were not able to get any runs on the board and gives LaSalle a chance to work their way back into this game.
However, when you haven't given up any runs and you already have four, you can afford to not take advantage of every runner in scoring position as they stranded a runner on second. The Blue Hens still are ahead four runs. When we come back, we'll see the eighth inning and we'll see how this one reaches its conclusion.
Delaware, number 33, Jake Clark.
Welcome back to Bob Hanna Stadium here at the University of Delaware, where the Blue Hens have just made their first pitching change of the day. Chad Cool's day is over, and he will be replaced by Jake Clark.
Jake Clark only has 9 appearances on the year, but boasts a .87 ERA and has 1 win in 10 innings pitched.
See, this is a good opportunity to get one of your little-used pitchers some game experience late in the season, non-conference play. Ahead 4 already, not a save opportunity. And he will see Justin Kornblatt, the right fielder. The left-handed right fielder. Clark misses low for his first pitch of the afternoon. 1 ball, no strikes. There it is. First strike of Jake Clark's afternoon. 1 ball and 1 strike. From this point forward, we'll just be referring to pitcher as Clark, as both teams have a Clark on the mound. So Clark misses high for ball 2. 2 balls and 1 strike. Foul ball out of play down the third baseline. 2 balls and 2 strikes with nobody down here in the top of the 8th inning. And the pitch lined right back up at Jay Clark. The quick hands finds it in his mitt, and he will toss over to first base for the first out of the 8th inning.
An impressive play by Jake Clark. Definitely could have been a Web Gem nominee on Baseball Tonight. I don't know, Tim, what do you think?
I think so. I think those reactions are pretty impressive. He comes right off the bench ready to play, fields the ball that would have gone between his legs, but instead finds its way into his glove.
Definitely a welcome to the game moment for him.
And now he will see Kevin Conroy, and hopefully this out can be a little less dramatic for him. Misses inside for ball number 1. And there's a hard hit ball into the gap between shortstop and third base, and that will be a single for Kornblatt. Neither Stoltzfus or Niggerbrugge even had time to make a move on that before it was past them.
So that's 2 hard hit balls in a row against Clark. So let's see if he can work his way into this game and get some better pitches over the plate.
Yeah, I don't want to say lucky on the first pitch because it wasn't incredible play, but it was kind of fortunate that it was hit right at a player.
Yep.
That last one, it was able to find a gap and down for a single. Strike on the check swing for Mark Williams, the first baseman for the LaSalle Explorers, who has grounded out 3 times, 1 time into a double play. Big swing from Williams, foul tips it for strike number 2. No balls and 2 strikes as Clark gets ahead in the count. Clark taking his time, as is Williams in the batter's box. There's the pitch. Misses just outside for ball number 1. Trying to paint the corner for strike number 3.
Clark signaling to Warrington to keep his zone down so he can keep that pitch down as well.
Yeah, Warrington's managing a different pitcher for the first time today after Cool. Check swing by Williams. Did not go around, as Warrington appealed to the umpire in right field. Clark taking a page out of the Cool strategy, ready to pitch as soon as Williams gets in the batter's box. There's the pitch, and Williams gets under into left field. Travellini giving chase, and he will make a nice running catch for out number 2 of the 8th inning.
A beautiful catch by Travellini, right in line with the rest of Delaware in their fielding today. They have put on a fielding exhibition, getting all sorts of outs and definitely helping the pitching out.
Yeah, it's almost like the only thing the pitchers have to do is throw strikes. You're either going to get a strikeout or they're going to put it in play, and this phenomenal defense is going to do something for you.
Definitely. With all the experience that's on this team, that's what you would expect.
And that's what you'd expect out of this outfield on that last play. The speed by Travellini made that play routine, and it really wasn't. That was a gapper against most outfields, but Travellini is able to track it down and make the nice over-the-shoulder catch. Hopefully they'll be able to do something similar as Joey Revert steps into the batter's box and faces Clark. Clark checks the runner at first, and the pitch misses outside for ball number two. Two balls and no strikes. There it is, a pop fly into shallow left field. Travellini underneath it, and that one's much more routine than the last out. Travellini puts it away for the third out of the eighth inning. When we return, we will see the bottom half of the eighth. Welcome back to Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Derek Coleman as we begin the bottom half of the eighth inning. LaSalle has begun to employ the pitcher per inning strategy. As the third consecutive inning, we will see a new pitcher in Luke Riley.
And on the ERA carousel that LaSalle has put out today, Luke Riley has a 9.82 ERA in 10 appearances and an 0-1 record with 7.1 innings pitched on the year. So not too much innings this year, Tim.
Yeah, if you're going to throw someone out there with a 9-plus ERA, I'm not sure you want them seeing Joe Chiquino, DJ Long, and Jimmy Yezzo, the premier, the first three batters of this Delaware lineup, and kind of the more experienced hitters of this Delaware lineup as well. But, you know, they don't play the game on paper. We'll see what Luke Riley is able to do against this prolific Delaware offense.
No, definitely. For a freshman like Riley, seeing these experienced batters is definitely going to be a difficult battle for him, so
yeah,
we'll see how it plays out.
We're going to see how the pitcher handles these batters, and we're going to see if these batters really make this new pitcher, Luke Riley, work. I'm sure they're going to try and see a lot of pitches. I'm sure they're going to try and take advantage of any mistake pitches and you know, really put a few more runs on this board and make this 4-0 lead grow. Here's the pitch. And his first pitch of the day is in there for a strike. And the pitch. Off-speed pitch in there for a strike. So Luke Riley comes off the bench, throwing strikes, no balls and two strikes with nobody out here in the bottom of the eighth. And that one, Chiquino is able to make good contact with, puts it into right field for a single, and the leadoff man is on for Delaware.
Good solid hit by Joe Chiquino. He's used to leading off and leads off again with a nice single.
Yeah, so he finds himself two for four today with a walk and reached on an error. So he's been on base, it seems like, all day today. And DJ Long will come to the plate attempting to advance him.
Let's see if Chiquino can get in this pitcher's head as well and make a couple pickoff attempts.
Yeah, it seems like every new pitcher they bring up has to deal with Chiquito on the base paths. Hard hit ball by Long into right field, and this one will fall innocently foul.
Too far of a run for right fielder Kornblatt to make.
Yep, gave it a little bit of a try before realizing there's no point and continuing to jog the rest of the way. DJ Long puts good contact into this into left center field. Conroy is able to get under it, and Giacchino will retreat back to first base.
Two solid contact hits for DJ Long, but unfortunately not in any places that could get him on base.
Yeah, he wasn't able to advance Giacchino either, so not a productive out. However, you know, he put good contact on. You can't really be upset with that. And now we'll see Jimmy Yezo. We've talked about him extensively today. Hasn't really lived up to the expectations aside from a single and run scored in the fifth inning. We'll see if he's able to change that up and put good contact into this pitch. Riley misses low for ball number one. Being careful with the leading average hitter in the country. And the pitch. Big cut by Yezo to no avail. One ball and one strike.
Yezo was way out in front of that one. Was not expecting whatever pitch Riley came at him with.
Yeah, Riley doesn't appear to be an overpowering pitcher, kind of a junk baller, throwing a lot of off-speed stuff. Yezo wasn't expecting that one. Riley misses low, two balls and one strike. Misses low yet again, three balls and one strike, being very careful with the prolific hitter Yezo.
Riley seems like he's almost afraid to put it out there in front of Yezo, but that fear is well warranted because Yezo can put it out of the park if you put it in the wrong spot.
Yeah, any mistake pitches, he's going to take advantage of. Runner goes, and that's a walk. So Yezo finds himself on first base, pushing Giacchino to second, and that will bring Nick Ferdinand to the plate.
Not batting for Delaware, number 20, Nick Ferdinand.
Nick Ferdinand already today has two walks and a triple. So he's, again, one of those batters that seems to have been on base all day. And now he'll have the opportunity to bring in an RBI with Giacchino standing on second. With Giacchino's speed, pretty much any base hit will bring home a run. Another insurance run for these Delaware Blue Hens. As Riley misses low for ball number one, one ball and no strikes. Here with one out in the bottom of the eighth. Barring something ridiculous from the LaSalle hitters in the batter's box, this could be last licks for the Delaware offense. Big swing by Ferdinand. Misses for strike number two. One ball and two strikes.
Once again, it looks like Riley had him guessing with another off-speed pitch.
Yep, definitely had him a little off balance there. And the pitch. Hard hit ground ball over to Day at second. Attempting to turn two, and they do to get out of the eighth inning. That'll bring us into the final inning of this contest between the LaSalle Explorers and the Delaware Blue Hens. Blue Hens go into the ninth inning. Ahead four runs to nothing. When we return, we will see the conclusion of this baseball game. Out.
pitching for Delaware, number 35, Eric Buckland.
Welcome back to the beginning of the ninth inning here on Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Derek Coleman. We have yet another pitching change. Delaware Blue Hens will throw Eric Buckland out on the mound.
Buckland, one of the senior leaders for this Delaware team, has a 4.34 ERA, 3-3 in 18 appearances this season with three saves, although this is not a save opportunity for him.
So as long as Buckland does his job and gets out of this inning without giving up less than four runs, this will be the final half inning of baseball here in Bob Hanna Stadium. He is facing Ryan Welling, the catcher. And his first pitch is in there for a strike on the outside corner. Nice pitch from Buckland. And he catches Ryan Welling swinging. Awkward half swing from Welling. Strike nonetheless. No balls and two strikes.
Buckland with that sidearm throwing motion, easy to throw batters off that way.
Yeah, definitely a change of pace from the two pitchers they've seen already today. That time he misses just outside. Looked good from up here in the booth, but umpire did not agree. One ball and two strikes. And there he goes. He will sit down with a strikeout. Eric Buckland comes off the bench and strikes out his first batter faced.
And Buckland does what a closer is supposed to do, come in, throw some hot pitches, and get out the batters.
And now we will see George Smith Jr., who already has been walked twice. Buckland, at least in his first batter, looked like he had his control working. Hopefully he'll have the same here against George Smith Jr. Misses just outside for ball number one. One ball and no strikes with one down here in the top of the ninth.
Buckland, like the two pitchers before him, is wasting no time getting back in there and getting the next pitch up.
There he goes. George Smith Jr. strikes swinging. One ball and one strike. Yeah, Buckland absolutely operating with the same intensity and same rapid-fire nature as the first two pitchers we've seen from the Delaware Blue Hens. Missing outside, ball two. Two balls and one strike. And the pitch. Swinging yet again for strike number two. Two balls and two strikes.
Buckland on the cusp of another strikeout here, so let's see if he can find the pitch to give him that third strike.
Yeah, see if he has that knockout pitch. And there it is. And there it is on the outside corner of the plate. Strikeout number two and two batters for Eric Buckland.
Buckland is coming with that heat, and they're just not ready for it over there in the LaSalle dugout.
And Colin McGowan, the shortstop, will be the final opportunity for the LaSalle Explorers to continue this game. And Buckland is waiting in the stretch already, not wasting any time. The intensity, you can see it in his body language. And the pitch in there for a strike. No balls and one strike.
It's Friday night. Eric Buckland wants to go home right now, Tim.
Yeah, he must have a hot date on this early weekend. He is trying to get out of this game quickly. Misses outside, ball, one ball, and one strike. And immediately right back into the stretch. He is wasting no time. He wants McGowan sat down quickly. Misses just outside. Thought he may have been able to get the call on that one. Instead, it's 2-1, two balls and one strike. That one in the dirt off of Warrington's padding, I guess it was.
and bounces well behind the plate. Three balls and one strike.
And Buckland sees himself in his first little bit of trouble today in this inning.
Yep, finds himself behind in the count. Three balls, one strike. I'm sure he'll attack McGowan here. And that'll be ball four, and McGowan will trot down to first with a walk.
LaSalle keeps themselves alive for one more batter. Let's see what Buckland comes out with this next at-bat.
And now they send Brandon Day to the plate. He is their nine-hole hitter, comes into today batting only 114. So not exactly their best hope to keep this game alive, but you never know. Buckland's still going to have to make pitches, still throw strikes. There's the pitch in there for strike number one.
And he wastes no time getting that first strike out of the way.
I'm sure he wouldn't mind to have three strikeouts in his one inning of play. Misses low and outside. Ball one. One ball and one strike. Sets. And fires. Misses outside yet again. Two balls and one strike. After mowing down his first two hitters, having a little bit of control problems here, missing outside quite often. Day settles into the batter's box, and here's the pitch. Big swing from Day for strike number two. Two balls and two strikes.
And there goes Buckland again, getting back into it with two strikes now. Let's see if he can get this third strikeout, third out, and end the game for the Blue Hens.
And that will do it. Three strikeouts for Buckland in the top of the ninth. The Blue Hens are able to pull out the win here against the LaSalle Explorers. 4-0.
It wasn't a pretty victory, but it was just that, a victory. They got just the Blue Hens got just enough hitting that they needed, and their fielding was excellent to keep LaSalle off the scoreboard. The pitching, Chad Cool going seven innings. You had Davis coming in and Buckland. All the pitching did great today, along with the defense.
Again, if you wish to see the first six innings of today's broadcast, that will be put up on Hens All Access Archives. Be sure to stick with Hens All Access for all of your Blue Hens athletics needs. Until next time, thanks for watching Hens All Access.